with joy unspeakable. With peace that passes understanding, with the glory of heaven. Woohoo! Come worship, come worship, bow down. Let what the seraphim is doing be eclipsed by the glory moving in ya. Come now, shout to the Lord. Lift your voice in praise and song. Tastugakuapakaya. Kastapatiarakosatoyanami. Kayosapodade. Kayosapokiadabeki. Kayosapodanaya. Kayosapiraki. Kayosatidanetakatia chapea lakatea. Hallelujah. 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 Come lift up your voice and joy and rejoice and. Come lift up your voice in joy and celebration. Come lift up your voice unto the Lord Most High. Kalsaya baku ya breve na manehe he. Zebreve na mamandehura. God, the Holy Ghost would love to lead you in some worship here this morning. God, just lift up your head, lift up your hands, lift up your gates, all ye people, and the King of Glory shall come in. It doesn't matter if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've been saved as long as Methuselah lived. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to take a hold of you and begin to express through you the glory of the Son, the glory of the Son, Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Say, Father, we thank you for the glory of the Son, Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you for the glory of the Son. Come on now. Look, we're going to even put the words in your mouth. We thank you for the glory of the Son, Christ Jesus. You know, the Lord said to Jeremiah, I put my words in your mouth. So you may speak unto this people. Hey, God the Holy Ghost has come and put the words of the Father in our mouth that we may speak unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Why don't you just forget about all the oppression that is upon this world that affects and infects so many of God's people, maybe even you. And just now go ahead and get raptured away into a realm of glory. The door's open before you. God the Father say, come on in, take yourself a look here. Come look, see how glorious this place is that I provided for you. Through the body of my only begotten Son, through his flesh, I made an entrance in. Satukika. Sabayapunanjaya. Bayarumgesh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All praise to you, Lord God. All praise to you, Lord Jesus. Blessed are the people whose God is the Lord Jesus Christ. So we want all of you to begin to look like you're blessed right now.
Hallelujah.
You know, yeah, people, you got up this morning and you worked on yourself in the mirror so that you would look better than you did when you first got up. Well, listen, I'm telling you right now, God wants to make you a whole lot, looking a whole lot better than you do right now. He wants to really fix you up. He wants to beautify you with all the glory of the salvation that he brought.
Woohoo! When he raised Jesus from the dead and set him on his own right hand and poured forth the gift of the Holy Ghost. God wants to brighten you up here this morning. He wants to light you up so you'll shine. Hallelujah, like a noonday sun. Hey, arise and shine, for the glory of God has risen upon you. Arise and shine, for your light has come.
Many of God's people do not know how to be led into the worship that the Holy Ghost has come to lead us into. And thus, great void is created. And in that void, Satan fills with all his works of iniquity and unrighteousness so that a Supreme Court will make a decision as it made almost a little over a week ago now, and lift its hands towards heaven with a boisterous statement and a presumptuous look and say, we're changing the laws of nature. We're changing the laws of God. And it's all our fault. Nothing to do with them. We the hinderer of iniquity. While we've been slap happy, congratulating ourselves on how anointed and how mighty we are, Satan's had a free run right up the middle. Because we were all sitting on the sidelines huddled up telling each other what a mighty team we had. Satan was running the ball, looking at us like we were a bunch of idiots. Just to kind of put it, you know, in a way that maybe you can understand. I'm trying to lighten it up. This is going to be Holy Ghost light here this morning because I know that not too many people can handle the heavy. But it's about time God's people be willing to grow up in the things of the Spirit.
Yes.
No longer be under the oppression that is created by the God of this world, the Prince of the Power of the Air. What makes you sorrowful? What makes you sad? What's causing you to have less than an explosive river of his presence being made manifest from you? The oppression that is in this world, the Spirit that is in the atmosphere. The Prince of the Power of the Atmosphere, the God of this world, the children, the Spirit that works in children of disobedience. Oh, yeah, you love the Lord. Oh, yeah, you do. Oh, yeah, you've given your life over to the Lord. Oh, yeah, you've been made a new creation. No question about it. Just never knew how to break through all the strategies of Satan and all the things that he's done to try to keep you from being whom God made you to be when he created you anew in his Son, Christ Jesus. And then, you know, if you follow me on Twitter or you follow me on Facebook, you've been hearing the things that I've been saying in a very radical and public way. Since last Friday, I was driving down Highway 199, just about to turn on Coast Highway the other night. And the Spirit of the Lord said, it's my judgment against the church. Because of the sin and the iniquity, it's my judgment. Because this thing's going to shut you down. It's going to take your 501c3 away. This is going to begin. There's so many people, it's like, I remember one day it was probably about 15 years ago, Jeanette was out ministering on the street and somebody came up to her and said, I didn't even know that people like you existed anymore. As she was radically telling somebody about the things of God, you know, how that they must be born again, how they must repent and believe on the name of the Lord Jesus. We've basically come under a gag order. Satan created a gag order through his fear and intimidation really right at about 25 years ago. And it really began to take hold on the church to where the church became so humanized, came under the spirit of humanization, a humanization spirit. What I say, a spirit of humanism is to merely make us as just ordinary, everyday human beings that have no real better insight or understanding of reality than anyone else. So it's all live and let live, and don't anybody put anything else on anyone else. We're all basically, you know, here, you know, and doing our very best, and what we think and what we believe and our insights are pretty much equal. Nonsense. God has commanded us to go everywhere and command people to repent. And being audio, you don't want to do that and soft-pedal the gospel, you know, and just make it something different than it is. I'm telling you right now, the gospel will not work unless you believe it like God described it and declared it. The gospel, the new birth, the new creation, the divine nature, this wonderful reshaping and reforming in the image and likeness of God after righteousness and true holiness, this washing of water of regeneration, renewing of the Holy Ghost will not work unless you believe it the way God designed it. You just have religion. You just have religious exercise. Religion? Religion scratches the belly of Satan. That's all it does. It scratches his belly. I praise God for authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. And it begins with my own life. It begins with my own life, where sin has no place in me, where Satan comes and he has nothing in me, where I'm at war. People don't even understand that concept of suffering and sacrifice and laying down your life and denying yourself. We've so backslidden, we've so gone out of the way. Huh? It's about time that there's somebody begins to respond. Somebody begins to have their eyes open. If you would, listen, the more you'll step over into the realms of the anointing and the glory, the more all of this rest of this stuff will become apparent. You know, when the lights come on, you can see what's been running around the place. I don't like eating restaurants that are dark. I want lots of windows and lots of light. I want to see what's under the table, on the table, in my food. I want to see what's on the walls. I want to look. I don't feel good. It's depressing to be dark or shadowy. Huh? I'm in the light. I love being in the light. I'm walking in the light, living in the light. Hallelujah. I don't want anything else but light. I don't like dark. Hallelujah. Books in Mopra. Next city Kinakata. No, the old timers, the guys that basically most of them are dead now, the ones that are alive are about 85 plus that I fortunately was so blessed to grow up around. They said a wave of rebellion swept the nations of the world and had its greatest impact in America and the United Kingdom. In the 60s. And what was before a tenderness towards God the Holy Ghost, what was before an ability of God's people to be easily influenced and separated by the Spirit of the Lord into a place called sanctification and consecration. You don't even hear about sanctification anymore. It's forgotten doctrine. And it's very fundamental to who we are. God said, I'm holy. I'm separate from everything that is other than me. I am separate from everything that is other than me. And I called you to come over here and be ye separate even as I am separate from everything that is other than me. Hallelujah. I've consecrated you to the light and there is no darkness there. Hallelujah. I command you to come out from among them. People believe that this verse of scripture belongs to the Amish. I commanded you to come out from among them. Be ye separate, saith God, and I shall receive you. Oh, no, God, you just got to take me just whatever. No, he's not going to. He said he's going to accept me how I am. No, he isn't. He's going to change you and make you like him. He's going to call you like you are. Any good? He's going to call you like you are. In his loving kindness, his grace and his mercy appears to all men. Calling us. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men. He calls everybody, no matter who they are, from the high priest of the Hebrew people to the rank immoral Scythian. Paul talks about the Scythians. They were the most immoral people in his day. He said equal. Equal? Well, to the Jew, that was blasphemy. Because the Jew in his mindset was, I'm clean. There's no uncleanness in me. I've been sanctified, separated by the covenant of Sinai. How can you say that I'm unclean? I'm not going to go near the Goyim. I'm not unclean. Oh, you're unclean. And then Jesus takes another one. I said, you're not only unclean, but your papa's Satan himself. Your father's the devil. That's a pretty radical sermon for Sunday morning, Jesus. How are you going to get out of a church growth plan talking like that? So this is what Judas' problem. This is Judas' problem. How are we going to get a church program going when as soon as we get a crowd of people together, you start saying stuff like, eat my flesh and drink my blood? How is it? How is it? Didn't you know that you also offend the lawyers when you said that about the Pharisees? Hey, we need the lawyers on our side. No, God's just interested in truth. He's in, God's going to separate. Father wants to separate in your life. No, we want to have itching ear doctrines of how we're going to all be successful, and we promote those who are nothing more than motivational speakers to tell us how wonderful we are, how good we're doing, and how much more we can have if we'll only believe. Nonsense. We see what that doctrine does. It results in the Supreme Court saying, tell you what, we in charge here now. Satan stepped on the scene and said, I'm in charge. There's no church here to make a disciple out of this nation. There's no hinderer of iniquity. I can make the rules. I tell you right now, you may just sit back and you may just yawn. I'm like fighting mad. I'm ready to punch something by the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm ready to bust something. I'm ready to smash something. In the spirit. Don't get too trembly there. Somebody's like, what is he saying? One person came to the meeting and said, is he allowed to talk like that? The answer is evidently. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the glory of your spirit and of your son I see on your servant Brittany. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for a great anointing, shake nations of the earth. Sapakteya. Frapakaya. Pratosinesteke. Mahatike. Ha! Sa! Mahatisaya Patesu! Abrataya Jaya Gazi! She's not gonna bend, she's not gonna bow. She got no smell or any smoke of this world on her. And I pray in Jesus' name, every one of you come to understand this wonderful thing that God has done for us. When he brought us unto himself and gave us permission and gave us the power to live in his glory, to live and walk under his mantle of authority, to where Satan has no access to us, where he can't touch us, giving us everything that we have need of. Somebody said, I just need a little more. No, you don't need nothing else. Because according to his divine power, he's giving us everything that we need. According to his divine power, he's given us everything that we need. Food and clothes and house and shoes. Not just one pair, but a closet full and a car and a lust for another one and this other thing and another, so that God's blessing might be seen in my super yacht. I'm telling you, man, I'm punching mad. I'm just going to have to understand. I'm sick of this stuff. I'm sick of it. And I want you to get sick too. I want to provoke you to good sickness. No, by his divine power, he's given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Not just life, human life, breathing in, out, huh? Need some more food, huh? Reproduction life. Listen to me. The life that God alone has. A life that is undiminishing, an eternal life. That eternal life, John personified eternal life. He said, that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us, we've now declared unto you. The world is waiting to see the eternal life, the life of Christ Jesus, the life of God, the life of the Holy Ghost manifested in us. There's two kinds of people that hate me, that dislike me extremely. Religious people and demon-possessed people. The demon-possessed people, we can take care of them by the end of the meeting.
Hallelujah. They just start having a fit on me in public. I love that. Didn't you just love that? Don't you just love it when you stand in front of a person, all of a sudden they just mad at you for no reason at all? It's foaming at the mouth. All that Satan is doing is saying, cast me out, cast me out, cast me out. I dare you, cast me out. I dare you. Hallelujah. So many people come under the influence of that. Oh, why is he got that attitude towards me? And then you just get the same attitude. You come under the same power of it. Because folks, God's people do not know how to live in a realm unaffected by the prince and the power of the air, the God of this world. They don't know how. They can't see what Satan is doing before it comes at them. They just think it's all a humanized realm. It's just all, well, you know, I didn't do anything and she showed me a bad attitude, so I'm going to show her a worse attitude. Or whatever, you know. Come on, people. Give me a break. It's about time you stand up and begin to shine. I don't know about you, but my light's come. I don't know about you, but the Supreme Court don't tell me what to do. Hallelujah. Somebody said, oh, that's lawlessness. No, they are lawlessness. I spent too much time in the House Church of China. I'm one of the worst criminals in the nation of China. The People's Republic of China doesn't take lightly that which we do because they see it as a threat against their national security. I'm used to this. This is like doing church to me, man. They can sanctify all they want. Sanctify all they want. The union between a man and a man, and a woman and a woman, and a dog and a man, and a goat and a woman, or whatever. Because it ain't going to stop. Because the door's open, people. Pandora's box is open. Polygamy is next. And there's a whole list of things I don't even want to mention that are on the docket right now. People don't know. And I look at all these supposed preachers of the gospel who have been given platforms, and they're sitting around acting like nothing's happened. I just figured that it's time to show and tell. You know what I'm saying? You can be seated. I want you to start showing and telling. Come on. Amen. Come on, Geneva. Praise God. Hallelujah. My Holy Ghost sister. Somebody said, you guys had an advantage. Your dad's a revivalist and you spent all your life in church three times a day, whatever. No. God will grow you up in a day. It's just you can't get a... We've been in this revivalist circles all of our life. We never got in religious circles. We just sat around and made fun of religious circles. That's all we did. At night, that's what we did. We didn't eat till late at night because that's an evangelist lifestyle. And we just sit around and make fun of religious people. Look at this people. My goodness gracious. They've come up to the door but didn't come in the house. They all camped out around the door. Talking about how good it is. Come in the house. It's a little better in here. You know, come on, people. It's time to enjoy the good things of heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's see. Receive the Holy Ghost. Right now, those of you who feel all bummed out and depressed and sorrow and sad and the heaviness of this life and your grades and the money in the bank and, well, you know, what somebody's opinion of you made you feel just terrible, I just tell you right now, receive the Holy Ghost. He wants to give you something better. Amen. Hallelujah. He wants to give you something better. And then you get to live, and if you'll just begin to receive it right here in the place in his house, this is where it is received. This good things of God are right here in his house. God made resident in his house all the working of the Holy Ghost. Listen to this. He made resident in his house all the working of the Holy Ghost. He placed in his church the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is how the church was born to begin with. When they were all overwhelmed by the rushing mighty wind and clothed in tongues of fire. And now we want to do something else. Give me a break. I don't want to do nothing else. I think that's the party. That's the promise of the Father. I'm not getting inducted into religion. I see lots of advantages of Judaism over Christian religion. In fact, I see advantages of Buddhism over Christian religion. In fact, I see advantages of Islam over Christian religion.
Hallelujah.
I'm not into Christian religion. I'm into Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, the eternal God, born of a virgin, manifested in the flesh as the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, overshadowed a woman named Mary of the house of David through the lineage and line of Nathan. Hallelujah. Nathan being one of David's sons, Solomon being another. Katayana. Matthew, that's the lineage of Solomon through Joseph. Luke, that's the lineage of Nathan. Hallelujah. To Mary. Hallelujah. When the fullness of time was come, God made him under the law. Hallelujah. Fashioned him there. He was born of a woman in the womb of a woman. So that you and I could be delivered out of darkness. Having been delivered and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son, to live now in the kingdom, to shine as those who are citizens of the kingdom, who have our citizenship in the kingdom. Father, calling people, you're going to have to quit tasting, touching, being moved, being touched by all the stuff that Jesus said, don't have anything to do with it. He said, don't be concerned about what you should eat and what you should wear. All these things are the oppression that the nation is under. That's what the nation seek after. Just go after the kingdom and after his righteousness. And you're going to have the wonderful and the beautiful blessings that flow down from on high. A realm that God provides for us because we're willing to walk with him.
Hallelujah.
You begin to walk with the Holy Ghost, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Who is going to stand up against all Satan's power and craft, who wields his authority through the lust of the flesh? Who? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. People want to talk about the flesh. They want to talk about the sin nature. They want to talk about this excuse and that excuse. And we're all men. I'm going to talk about Christ Jesus, he who is in me. I'm going to talk about the resurrected one who's raised up on the inside of me. I'm going to talk about the power of the Holy Ghost come upon me, overshadowed me, baptized me, filled me, with me, and in me. In that moment, I'm going to tell you right now, in that moment of your life, change begins. Suddenly you find yourself heir and co-inheritor, heir of God the Father. That's pretty radical. Oh, we should just believe that. I ain't about a new house or something. We have reduced riches. We have reduced it to something that can be monetized. It's absolute insanity in the full definition of the word. As far as I'm concerned, insanity means in Satan. It's insanity. True riches. He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. People want to be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the earthly realm. It will not work there. That's why people flock to their motivational teachers. They heap unto themselves, pile them up. I mean, it's a gigantic pile of teachers heaped to the heavens because they have itchy ears. They want to be told that they're right. They want self-justification instead of the righteousness which is by Christ Jesus. They want to hear about how right they are and how they can be better and how they can lust for more. They turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. Well, it's time to repent. And turn to the Lord. John came and he preached this message that the Lord assigned him to preach. He preached a message of the baptism unto repentance. They were baptized in repentance. And said, hey guys, I got some good news. I know things are a little bit tough right now because everybody just overwhelmed with the consciousness of sin, and they're repenting and crying out to God, but there's one coming after me. He's going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost, man. He's going to baptize you in a condemnation-free zone, where there is therefore now no condemnation, because you're in Christ Jesus, because you've been liberated, you've been truly set free. People want to talk about freedom being their allowance to do whatever it is they want to do. Nuts. Who ever defined freedom like that? Freedom is to be liberated from tyranny. Freedom is to be liberated from those things that cause pain and disease and destruction. and oppression. Jesus came with a glorious, liberating gospel, saying, the Spirit of the Holy Ghost is upon me. Yes. People talk in religion, they would say, oh, God, the Holy Ghost never speaks of himself. Listen, I've been raised around theologians, and everyone I've ever known rolls their eyes at that and says, what is wrong with those people? God, the Holy Ghost, they're saying that somehow the Holy Ghost doesn't talk about himself. That is nuts. Jesus is always talking about the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost isn't ashamed of himself. God the Father is talking about the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, the Holy Ghost is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He'll beautify the meek with his glorious salvation. What is the meek? They're those who are not self-willed. They'd rather do the will of the Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who? Blessed is his holy name. He'll beautify the meek with salvation. He pours forth his glory upon us. Just think about all this wonderful liberty and this freedom that we now have in Christ Jesus, no longer to live under the influences of the prince and the power of the atmosphere, the god of this world that would work in you the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, and make you think that it's pleasurable and desirable. It has certain pleasures for a season, but the end of it will destroy you. It'll be death to you. It'll be sickness. It'll be sorrow. It'll be pain. It'll be sighings. It'll be groanings. Go read what the preacher says in Ecclesiastes, who went out and sampled everything, tried out everything. He said the sum total of the matter is this: it's all vanity and vexation. Oh, there is only one purpose in life: it's fear God and keep his commandments. Yeah. Dear people, it's time that you become aware and you no longer walk around deceived or blinded in part or under a shadow of the influence of the prince and the power of the air, but recognize that all these things Satan would try to impose upon us, that the river of divine glory, that the heavenly realm would not be made manifest, that the life of Christ Jesus, all those things are synonyms, that the manifest presence of the Holy Ghost will not be revealed through us, because he would oppress us with financial issues. He would oppress us with our relationship issues. He would oppress us with things that we desire that are outside of the realms of that which Father has freely supplied to us. If God's people would just begin to understand and embrace all those things that he's given to us when he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. If God's people would just begin to embrace that they're the heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus Christ. If God's people would begin to embrace that he will superabundantly do above all that we can think or ask. You know, I've watched people apply that verse to Scripture to their finances. Who cares about your finances? You've got to get over that stuff, man. You got to get over what you eating. Give me a break. There's put too much value on food and clothing. When he said he's superabundantly able to do above all that we can think or ask according to the power that is at work on the inside of us, he was talking about coming into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, and described it on the scale of saying to know the length, the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, to there be filled with all the fullness of God. The fullness of God. Filled, baptized with all the fullness of God. So much so that it's like rivers of living water. It's like rivers. It's like rivers gushing out of you. My wife and I stood on the other side of Victoria Falls in Livingston, Zambia the other day, and I said, that's exactly what the Holy Ghost looks like coming out of me. That's right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why the type 1 diabetes that needs a monitor on the side. If the slightest little bit of decrease in sugar level begins to take hold of the body, everything begins to shut down. That's why it's cured in the name of Jesus, because I got something that looks like Victoria. When Victoria Falls met Niagara. Huh? Hallelujah. Come on, man. When you have that resource, when you have that glory, when Christ Jesus is in you, when you've said or been separated, when you see yourself a part of the kingdom of God, totally separated unto the Father, having now access by the Holy Ghost. I have access into a realm. I just go in. People need to quit being lazy and start praying in the Holy Ghost. You make fun of the Holy Ghost, you're going to know nothing about what I'm talking about. You're stuck in religion. You listen to me. Stuck in religion. People want to live in limbo. Call it Christian limbo. Praise God for the death of Jesus at the cross. Praise God for the resurrection. But something would come afterwards. The ministry of Jesus at the cross. The ministry of Jesus at the tomb. The ministry of Jesus, I could say, when he went down into hell for 3 days. The ministry of Jesus at the tomb when he was raised up from the dead. But he said, I'm sitting in the promise of the Father. My heavenly ministry is about to start. My heavenly ministry, I'll pour out the Holy Ghost upon you. Listen to me. Jesus did not come into this world. The Word of God could not come into this world without the Holy Ghost. Overshadowing someone who was willing to be yielded to the Holy Ghost. What if Mary didn't believe in the ministry of the Holy Ghost? Well, I just don't believe in it. And that Gabriel comes and said, well, the Holy Ghost would come upon you. Well, I don't believe the Holy Ghost comes on people in these days. That was back in Grandpa's day. That was back when Moses was alive, 1,400 years ago. You must be a false angel. I rebuke you now by the law of Moses. Christ Jesus never be made manifest. Or he had to go find somebody who does believe in the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Huh? Hallelujah. Jesus' ministry is the ministry of the Holy Ghost. That's how he was identified. John said, I did not know him after the Spirit, because he was John's cousin. You understand that? He was John's cousin. Mary and Elizabeth, close friends. Huh? In fact, John got filled with the Holy Spirit in an old covenant way at the greeting of Mary, saying, hey, Elizabeth. That's the way our conversation ought to be. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Pura katana maze. When we carry around Jesus on the inside of us, our salutation ought to cause people to get filled with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. It should be a joyful sound instead of a sad sound. You know, arguments, strifes, whatever goes on. Pura baba segedini. You know, that's one of the big things about it. Many people just know themselves after the flesh. They don't know themselves after the Spirit. Paul, one day he had an experience with Jesus on the road to Damascus. But he had a greater experience. He discovered that God had purposed to reveal Jesus in himself. He said, when I come to by revelation to understand that Father separated me from my mother's womb that he might reveal his son in me, I conferred no longer with flesh and blood, but went up into Arabia. And there for 3 years God unveiled to him the glory of the new covenant, the Son revealed in you and me. I'm telling you, man, when you begin to be separated under this, isolated, consecrated, you delivered out of the realms of that which people are overwhelmed by, that which you experience in a purely human fashion. You listen to me. Yes. Having been spoiled by traditions and by philosophies, by the rudiments of this world, instead of being established in Christ Jesus, established in the faith. What is the faith? The faith is Christ Jesus. What is the faith? The faith is now to be born again by Christ Jesus. What is the faith? To be made a new creation. What is the faith? The promise of the Holy Ghost. That is what the faith is. People want to say that Paul's got a different definition of faith than Peter does. That Paul has a different definition of faith than Jesus. That's nonsense. All Paul did was to begin to describe and express those things that we have that Jesus said contained in the four Gospels. He just began to focus them down and into the realms of the glory that we are now supposed to live in. But what we do is we give our thoughts and we give our thinking and we give our manner of living over into a realm that the prince and the power of the air has designed, influences. He's the one who set it up. It is a state of rebellion and of darkness, and we basically give ourselves completely over to his system. And we operate under his debt and under his tyranny. When the Lord said that you and I are supposed to make disciples out of nations. It's time to get turned around. Listen, I'm telling you right now, you girls from Kerala, India, you watch out. You better get into this because God, the Holy Ghost, is about to come down on the nation of India. And 1.2 million people are about to have one of the greatest explosions of the 1.2 billion people about to ready to have one of the greatest explosions of the power of the Holy Ghost manifested. And you don't want to be sitting on the sidelines because you came to America and got more religionized. Are you listening to me? You listen, I'm telling you right now, India is about... What's going on in China is beautiful. Kyrgyzstan's not left out. Kyrgyzstan, you listen to me. I'm passionate about Kyrgyzstan. Why didn't Holy Ghost people run to Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia, as soon as the claw of the Russian Empire, the Soviet Union, was released? Why? We want to do our little circuits where we can collect our finances and feel better about ourselves and be in the place of getting promoted to being this superstar of the church. It's nuts. I hope you're listening to me. I know a lot of people around the world are listening to me right now. I know there's a lot of folks, a lot of ministers listening to me, and I'm just so blessed that you agree with me. So you need to start saying it from the platform the Father's given you. Start speaking it. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's because it's true. It's about time we just basically recognize that we need to repent. What is repentance? You know, really, you know, a man of God was talking to me, the Lord Jesus, in a wonderful way. I love him with all my heart. Pat Schatzline was talking to me about revival. I said, Pat, forget about revival, man. We're not ready for revival. You have to have a turning back to God before you have revival. The church doesn't want to turn back to God. They want to go. There's too many people telling them, confirming their deception. And, you know, we all have the Bible to read. You can read the Word of God. Fact of it is, people don't read the Word of God. You can read the Bible. If you basically give yourself 1 hour a day, you'll read the Bible in 90 days, from cover to cover, Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. Huh? People don't do it. They don't want the whole counsel of God. They want to just basically go over to the little, you know, bread of promise basket and pull out a little verse of scripture, you know, and that's it for the day. Why don't you eat like that? I'd say that would be, let's see, what would that be? That would not even be a spoonful of egg. That's all you get. Open your mouth. This is it. Enjoy it. One spoonful of egg. And you're going to live off of that all day. Why don't you start delighting yourself in the Word of God? Why don't you understand that there's all this demonic communication going on around you in this world? And that, by and large, people don't even know how to shut the thing down. They got it wide open. They're tuned into it in every dimension of life, from the marketplace to the workplace to even the home place. I mean, they've got Hill's box office sent to the max, on and on. You know what I'm saying? You can't sit and watch that stuff and not be absolutely taken over by demon spirits. Yeah, my goodness gracious, you need to go get clean. Huh? Listen to me. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You can go get, take a bath in the Holy Ghost. Get that nonsense off of you. That mess. And then there's very little time for the Word of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost. People just want to make the communion of the Holy Ghost just some little subjective thing, whatever thought they went through their mind. Those thoughts went through your mind probably has nothing to do with the Holy Ghost. Huh? Especially if you basically are being constantly inundated with those things that Satan is doing, the spirit of this world that now works in the children of disobedience, whom all of us had our conversation or our manner of life in times past. It's supposed to be times past, not present. It doesn't say whom we all had our conversations in times present. Our manner of life. Our conversation's in heaven now. The realms of divine power and glory is supposed to be issuing out of us. People, that there's so much to this wonderful life that we've received in Christ Jesus that goes far beyond, reaches far beyond all the things that we've tried to confine it to. We want you to understand that this life of walking in the Holy Ghost, of walking out relationship with the living God, is everything that you can begin to imagine that would go along with that, being heir of God. Is Satan going to come at you right, left, and center? Yeah, he is. But you got total authority over him. I see people get all upset and get real radical about God, a sickness or disease. Oh, I've got cancer. Pray for me. Why don't you get that radical about the sin going on in your life? You wouldn't have the cancer. So I just can't seem to touch the realm of heaven. Look, get rid of the leaven, you'll have heaven. Huh? People talking about, well, we need to straighten out the church. You need to straighten you out. Are you listening to me? Yeah. You need to straighten. You need to get yourself some watchmen going on around in your life. You need to understand that God has called you and separated you unto himself. He said, come out from among them. Touch not the unclean thing. Maybe the people just haven't ever gone around and identified the unclean things. And that's why they're not only touching them, man, they got the arms around them. They got a backpack unclean. You know what I'm saying? And I will receive you. I'll be your father. You be my people. You'll be my children. Jesus said, obey me. Do what I say to do. My father will love you. That freaks people out. Well, I thought God so loved the world. He did. And he does. But it's not a relationship love. It's a love of compassion, reaching out, calling all men to salvation. It doesn't have a relationship with the world. How many of you believe that Father has a relationship with the world? How many of you believe that everybody that's born of a woman is a child of God? It's not true. It's not true. Jesus said, your father is the devil, and his works you do. I don't want these bugs bugging me. I don't want any mark of Satan on me. People all talking about 666. Let me tell you about sin. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye and pride of life. That's the mark of Satan. It's a satanic mark. Huh? It contaminate you. Somebody said, oh no, we're in trouble. Yeah, you are. Good thing God's got lots of mercy. If you want to get this right, he has separated you now to train you to get it right. Hallelujah. Oh, no, here's where people do. They capitulate. Oh, we're all going to sin more or less every day. Get ready for sin. Why don't you go with, oh, we're going to do righteousness more or less every day. Amen. Get ready for righteousness. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to teach us all the ways of God. People aren't going to like heaven. People aren't going to like heaven. Many people sitting in church aren't going to like heaven. Because all the stuff that they enjoy and gets them all happy and excited ain't going to be there. God's come to teach us the ways of life. We are saturated and inundated in the system of the world with everything that belongs to hell, the ways of unrighteousness, the ways of wickedness. God has separated us unto himself by Christ Jesus, so that now, being separated by the wonderful work of divine grace, we are the temple of the Holy Ghost who's with us and in us. You don't have to be concerned about anything. He's with you and in you. Oh, I just wish I could feel him. My goodness, you're supposed to have a river. If you said that, if you said, oh, I wish I could feel him, you can start rejoicing right now, because you come to the right place. We're going to make sure that you can feel him in your soul. And he brings us this desire to do that which is right. He brings us this desire to please the Father. He brings us the desire to love righteousness and hate iniquity. Did you know that Jesus learned obedience? Are you learning obedience? Do you have the spirit of obedience, or do you have the spirit of disobedience? If you have the spirit of disobedience, we're here to set you free from that tyranny and that darkness and that deception, so that now you can receive the spirit of obedience and be taught of God. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, this wonderful grace, Father, keeps the new creation intact so long as we're willing to be taught. How much will he forgive us when we're wanting to get it right? Oh, God, I'm a slow learner, Lord. I'm having a hard time getting a hold of this. I go to the church, I remember, then I leave the church and I forget. And here I've stumbled into this place again. And now you're grieving, and you've got conviction over sin. Isn't that beautiful? It's not a culture of condemnation. That's a wonderful blessing of Holy Ghost conviction. And there's the blood of Jesus to cleanse us, to keep us separated unto himself. Satan's going to come along and try to minister condemnation. There's no condemnation. All I have to do, there's no death sentence, in other words. There's no, hey, you know what? I'm done with you. You've already had, like, what? I'm like, I'm counting at least 1,000 chances. I'm counting at least 1,000. You did what Adam did at least 1,000 times over. You know what? Over. Next. He's not doing that. He says, I'll give you unlimited forgiveness. When Jesus said 7 times 70, it's a Hebrewism that means an unlimited number. You got to do something. You got to quit being ornery. Huh? You have to be willing to forgive and show mercy to everybody around you. Otherwise, you don't get any forgiveness. You're not going to receive any mercy. If you're not going to give it, you're not going to receive forgiveness unless you're going to give it. And how is that going to come? Because you're allowing the love of God to fill you by the Holy Ghost. He's poured His love into us by the Holy Ghost, which He's given to us. We've been sealed with the Holy Ghost of promise. Did you know that? Have you ever read Ephesians 1:13? You know what it means? I'm here to tell you what it means. I've been anointed by the Holy Ghost here to tell you what it means. Hallelujah. I've come here not just speaking in tongues. If I come unto you speaking in tongues, what should it profit you? Hallelujah. If I come to you only speaking in tongues, because Paul just spoke in tongues all the time. It was his chief doctrine. That's why first thing he sees disciples, he looks at him and goes, you guys speak in tongues yet? Is the divine language? That's what he said. He gets to see people. First thing he does, you got the divine language? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Ephesians, you look at it, Acts 19. First thing he said, you guys got the divine utterance yet? His first thing he said, he looked at him and said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And we know exactly what that means. Because he laid hands on them, they all began to speak with other tongues. Hallelujah. The divine utterance. Why would we neglect that which God has given us to strengthen us and build us up in the most holy faith? Huh? Why? Because Satan's influence that wants to make the riches of God look like dust and dirt and foolishness. I'm going to flip this thing around. Amen. I'm going to flip this thing around. I'm going to tell you right now. I used to be wondering, well, we need to have more people. The Lord said, no, just 2 or 3 is enough. Just 2 or 3. I've got 7,000 haven't bowed the knee anyways. All I need is 300 men. Huh? Look. When all of the empires of the world, the 4 kings came up against the 5 kings, the 4 kings of the great empire of Abraham's day came up against the 5 kings of the plain. The greatest empire of the 4 kings destroyed the 5 kings of the plains, Sodom and Gomorrah being 2 of those highlighted. Abraham takes a few of his servants and goes and beats all of them. Huh? Come on, man. Abraham, who's got a relationship with God, goes and conquers the world. With a couple of servants. Huh? Why? Why? Because his nephew's over there. Because his one nephew. Because his nephew and his wife and kids. Come on. Just think about the authority that we've been given. As many as believed what Jesus has said and received what he's given, he's given us the authority to be the sons of God. And we're not just talking about casual, common sons. There's seraphims and cherubims and there's common angels. I mean, these doctrines that people have. But nonetheless, we just come and say, no, there is only one son. Yes. Yeah. Amen. We don't even exist outside of Jesus. Yeah, our whole existence is in him. Yeah. But yet that's good doctrine. So we're into orthodoxy, but I don't think we're really that passionate about orthopraxy. Because we're going to be willing to have other manifestations other than the son. Not me. And if I see other manifestations or things trying to impact my life, I'm going to rise up against it. I'm going to smash it. I'm going to smash it. I'm going to just say smash. So I give you authority to smash. To tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. I'm telling you right now. People, it won't be long. You'll be casting out devils in dreams. I was casting out devils in my dreams last night. I'm going to kill all these bugs before it's over. Amen. Because it's just that time, dear people. It's time. It's time. It's time to be stirred. It's time to know whose side you're on. It's time to know what manner of people you are. Huh? It's time not to know each other after the flesh anymore, but to know each other after the Spirit. Paul said, we don't even know Jesus after the flesh anymore.
We knew him as the son of Mary and Joseph, but now we don't know him after the flesh anymore. We know him after the Spirit. Do you know yourself after the Spirit? Have you been born of the Spirit? Do you know yourself after the Spirit? Do you know you've been made one with the living God? You know you made that. Do you know that you've been made heirs with him, co-inheritors with him, that your spirit is joined unto the Lord and you're one spirit with the Holy Ghost? Do you know yourself after that? Because I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lot of pressure on you to know yourself after your flesh, after the realms of your failings, your limitations, all your worries and all your uncertainties. It's hard to have faith living in so much doubt. You're going to have to start nurturing some faith. You know what faith is? Did you know that but when faith came? How many of you know what I'm talking about when I say, but when faith came? Right? Galatians 3, 24, isn't it? Or 23, what is it? But when faith came. When did faith come?
Jesus.
But when faith came. Ha, prosatananeas. Ha, kotamanea. What does faith look like? Faith is every dimension of the person in the life of Jesus. Faith is everything about that which belongs to the realms of the kingdom of God. John said, I didn't know him. I thought I forgot. John said, I didn't know him after the Spirit. But I knew this. The Spirit of the Lord told me, God told me, God the Holy Ghost showed me. He said, whomever you see the Holy Ghost come upon and remain, he's the one. And I saw heaven open. I saw somebody said to me the other day, said, we're just believing God for an open heaven. I said, give me a break. Don't even say that around me anymore. Don't even say that around me anymore. That's like cussing. Heaven was open 2,000 years ago, and it's never closed. The door's wide open. The Lord didn't shut the door and lock it. Keep them out. I'm tired of dealing with those people. That's, you know, people, pastors that were into the thing for success. I just can't stand the people. Why can't you stand the people? Because, no, listen, God loves the people. God's not a pastor like that. He loves the people. The door's wide open. He's saying, everybody, come on in. Did you know that? He gave peace to everybody. Do you know he gave peace to you? You know what peace is? Absence of condemnation. He said, peace to those who are near and to those who are far away. Come on in. Before he said, draw not nigh. You can't come near me. Draw not, not. Moses can come. He said, all the rest of you, you're not coming near me. And if anybody steps across the line, dead. Somebody said, well, that's another God. No, same God. He said, I will not mix it up with those things that are other than me. I'm not mixing it up. And this is the grace and the truth that came by Christ Jesus. Where Father made a way to where that we can come on in without him having to mix up with otherness. He sanctified us, set us apart unto himself by the blood of the covenant, whereby we are sanctified. Whereby our garments are whiter than snow. There is no there is no stain of sin and iniquity. So that now you and I can live in this place of union with the Father, union with the Son. Jesus said, if you obey me, my Father will love you. And we will come and make our dwelling with you. People have no idea what's coming, what's about to happen. Preachers don't have any idea. People sitting in church don't have any idea. It's just that's the way it is, you know. We don't see till it's done. When all the time, God the Holy Ghost has come to show us things that are about to happen. And there's a few people see it, screaming and hollering, going, guys, don't you see, don't you understand, don't you know? It's not time to walk out on God. It's not time to walk out on the meeting. It's time to get on your face before God and start pleading. Oh, yeah. You know, God comes with his glory and comes with his moving. We'll sit around in our little, you know, doctrinal armchairs and criticize the move of God. And that was ultimately God's means by which he would then bring us to a place of turning back to him so that revival could take place, so that an awakening could take place in a nation and the nation could be preserved. I'm not concerned. I'm not concerned about it. But most people should be. Because I'll walk through the fire and not be burned. 1,000 shall fall by my side and 10,000 by my right hand, and will not come nigh to me, because I made the Lord my habitation, my dwelling place. But everybody else needs to be concerned that hasn't made him his dwelling place. Look at me. Listen to me. It's not time to start moving in faith and start, you know, when you basically got 4-stage cancer. Huh? Are you with me? It's not time to start moving in faith when disaster is all about you. Huh? Because you've given your whole life to being overwhelmed and giving your passions and your emotions to fear. It's going to be very difficult. Right now, God the Holy Ghost has come to us as Jesus came to the disciples to train them. God the Holy Ghost has come to train us, to show us how to move in all the realms of divine power and glory. And that should be the most important thing in our lives. That's what we were separated by the blood of Jesus Christ, sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ. How many of you in this place are holy? Raise your hand. It wasn't too many years ago that people would go and you say, well, is there anybody holy in the place? And it was all just a lie and intimidation against God's people, acting like there's nobody holy. I'm holy. It's a gift. It's given to me. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Anybody righteous in the place? I am. It's a gift. It's a gift of righteousness that was given to you. You just know yourself out of the flesh, and your gospel and your doctrine and your idea of relationship with God is based upon your terms and your definitions. Because when it becomes based upon what God has said and what he's done for us in Christ Jesus, then we receive as a free gift all these wonderful things that belong to salvation. I had a preacher say to me one time, he said, you know, he asked me, you know, what my dreams and my visions and my goal, and I'm looking at him going, what are you talking about, man? And he said, well, I just figured that you were going to say that you're pressing on to become like Jesus. I said, what are you talking about, man? You need to go back and read the Bible. I already have that. It was given to me as a free gift. I didn't earn anything from God. He gave it to me. It might take you a while to receive the free gift because you stuck on earning something. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I want to get in the face of that ugly thing called bondage. You listen to me. I don't want you to be yoked again with the bondage of slavery. Huh? Trying to please God when he's made us pleasing. Oh, I just want to be pleasing God. Well, get in Jesus. Get over into Jesus. And you'll be pleasing in him. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. What is faith? Jesus. Faith. But until faith came. What is that? Galatians 3. 3:21. But after that, faith has come. Speaking to the Jews in Galatians, they were shut up unto the faith. They were shut up they were separated. They were consecrated. God had, you know, Father, and it's going to be very, very difficult for Father to bring forth his only begotten son through the Roman Empire. Are you with me? Through a bunch of Zeus worshipers. It's going to be very difficult for Father to bring forth his only begotten son in the Congo where they're all worshiping demons. Are you listening to me? So he sanctified a people unto himself. Huh? To stand there, to know who he is, to wait upon him, to stand before him in his presence, to begin to learn the basics about it, what it means to walk with him, to know who he is, to behold his glory. And they stood way outside. One man got to go in where everybody today is invited to come. One man, the high priest. One man, and him once a year. And you get to live there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365. Hallelujah. But we don't understand the riches. We don't value the riches because we're all caught up in, well, we got to make money and God understands and we got to, blah, blah. God don't understand none of that mess. Paul made tents, huh? But he gave himself to the true riches. His whole life was caught up, raptured up in Christ Jesus being revealed in him. Huh? He talked about Christ and me. He's manifested in my mortal flesh. Huh? I fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost from Jerusalem to Illyricum. That's what we're doing here today. If you're sick in your body, you can get healed. I don't care what kind of disease you've got. If you believe that Jesus is here, you're going to get healed. Jesus looks at the worst person that's possible can imagine in his day and said, if you just recognize who I am, I could just recognize me. I'm the deliverer. I'm the savior that loves you. Why could just recognize me? Recognize who I am and the gift
And out of you, you're immediately going to get happy. And you're immediately going to have a supply of life. Don't make it a struggle. Don't make it a struggle. Don't make the gift of God a struggle. It's not a struggle. The promises of God aren't a struggle. They're not a struggle. They're people. They're something that you receive. The struggle is all about you not willing, about you being unwilling to let something go. You hear me? Yeah. Just come running to Jesus. Come running and embrace that which He has freely given. And just find yourself so blessed to be here in this place with Him. And watch as He supplies to you everything that you have need of. And He's going to do it superly abundantly above all that you can think or ask. And it's not going to be needing an open heaven. So He's going to come down to heaven. So you got to go rise up there, go get Him, bring Him down. Oh, pray the glory down. Yeah. Pray the glory down. The glory's here. A power that is at work. If we're not going to believe the gospel, then faith's not going to work. And we're going to try to make it something. We're always redefining what God's defined. When you redefine what God's defined, it's something different. When do you believe? What day do you believe? God Almighty tabernacles on the inside of you. And then you believe that in your most crisis point. I don't need no motivational speaking when you can just begin to recognize God Almighty tabernacles on the inside of me. Jesus said, the glory that, look at this. He says it to people who aren't that bright and aren't that well put together. The glory that Father gave to me, I've given it to you so that you can be one. And then we want to, and I hear people, saying, oh, well, so that you and I could be one. That's why I decided not to be one with you. Okay? That's going to be real later. I'm one with Him first. And as soon as I'm one with Him, then I'll be one with you, okay? Yeah. But I'm not going to put the second thing first. Yeah. Put the first thing first. And so Jesus said, as the Father is in me, I'll be in you and you'll be in me. Ooh, what glory. Yeah. See, the Lord said, in that day. And so many people have not had that day. In that day, John 14:20, in that day, you should know that the Father is in me, that I am in you, and that you are in me. You need to have that day. I've had that day. I've had that day when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. He is with you, but He shall be in you. In that day, when He comes, when the Comforter comes, when the Paraclete comes, when the other leader, teacher, mentor, guide, instructor, the one that the promise of the Father. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost. How important is the Holy Ghost to you? How much do you talk about Him? Huh? Think about the things that are important to you. You're going to go for them first thing in the morning. Things that are important to you, they're going to be around you. You need them. Your keys. Where are my keys? Huh? The things that are important to you. Some people, it's like, the most important thing to them is their remote control. Where's my remote control? I wish you get that earnest about the Holy Ghost. Where's the Holy Ghost? Holy Ghost! Rise! Rise, oh God! I see an enemy coming against me, advancing against me with his lust, with his deception, with his lies, with his fear, with his intimidation. I've been delivered from the bondage of fear to fear no more. I've received the glorious liberty of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Son in me, the glorious liberty of the children of God. And here's these camps, here's these forces of hell now trying to advance against me. Arise, oh God! What am I talking about? I'm just talking about sin and temptation. People don't understand. The primary manifestation that you've been born again is that you're able to overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, young men, because the word of God abides in you and you've overcome the wicked one. You've defeated him at every point. Because you are strong and the word of God abides in you. Huh? This is the victory that overcomes. This is the conquering power. The word that we translate victory actually means conquering power. This is the conquering power that has conquered the world. Even our faith. What is our faith? I've been born again. That's the faith. I've been born of the Spirit. It's not some blind observance about something.
It's an act, an event that brought us into relationship. A relationship that you and I are to be set apart to. That we should be happy about. I'm sanctified. I've been baptized. I was born again. I was baptized, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. You don't even hear those kind of things anymore. That's like, what? What is that? You don't even hear that kind of confession anymore. What do you mean sanctify? What does that mean? Is that like, what is that? Somebody came to me one time and said, oh, we used to be holiness too. What? Yeah, we got delivered. You got delivered from holiness. What are you in now? What are you in now? Somebody said, oh, it's legalism. Legalism? Legalism, by definition in the Bible, is to trust in the law of Moses for righteousness. I don't know anybody doing that, except for the Haredim or the Orthodox Jews. Christians? You think, I don't know a single Christian that I can think of who could be lawfully accused of legalism, of trying to do anything to look like the people of God. Huh? With the definition of legalism. We got something better. Having now begun in the Holy Ghost. You also perfected by the Holy Ghost. You hear the rhetorical question that I just asked? Having begun in the Holy Ghost, are you now made perfect by the flesh? I'm saying, that's what is Galatians 3:3. Having begun in the Holy Ghost, you're now made perfect by the Holy Ghost. You get to grow and mature in the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. You get to be developed. There is a liberty. There is a grace. There is a mercy. So that if we sin, the blood of Jesus Christ will wash us, cleanse us. We have a propitiation. He is our propitiation. He is a ongoing, ever continuing offering made for us at the altar of God so that all of our sins are washed away. If we walk in the light as He is in the light, then the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us. It's an ongoing cleansing from all unrighteousness, all sin and iniquity, so that we stand holy and blameless. Hallelujah. And Holy Ghost is very happy. Holy Ghost, who by definition is sacred and holy, happy to dwell here. However, if we start saying, oh, we're going to sin more or less every day, it's inevitable, can't, and we be, because what happens is we're salving our own iniquity by a false doctrine and giving ourselves permission to practice sin, and you don't know God, you're cut off, you're backslidden. There's no blood to cleanse you there. You listen to me. There is no blood. There is no doctrine of blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse you, because that is fundamentally the willful sin, the practice of sin, the presumptuous sin. It's to practice it. It's to practice it and make an excuse for it. Are you listening to me? Yes. Hello? Yes. Father, giving you everything that you need by His divine power. I have a power at work on the inside of me that is greater than the authority of sin and Satan and everything that is in this world, and it needs to be activated in our life, and we need to yield ourselves. If you walk in the Holy Ghost, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Hallelujah. Understand, this is as many as are walking or led or under the authority and instruction of the Holy Ghost. These are the sons of God. It's a seal. It's a proof that you have been born of Him, that you no longer belong to yourself. You're not your own. You were purchased with the price. You belong to God. You're His possession. I want His seal upon me. Come on. And I'm looking around. I'm petitioning you. I'm begging you. I'm pleading with you. Have this seal upon you. Understand, you can't make it without the Holy Ghost. Don't stand in Christian limbo. Well, we believed in the cross. Well, the cross brought you to the resurrection, and the resurrection brought you to the Jesus heavenly ministry. John said, I'm baptizing you in repentance, but He's going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. That didn't happen until He ascended up on high. It's time, people, for us to get hungry for the things that God has separated us unto. God, the Holy Ghost, is that wonderful Spirit. Holy Ghost, Spirit of consecration or sanctification, because sanctification simply means to be under the rulership of the Holy Spirit. Sanctification is another word for holiness. Holiness is something that only comes to us by the living God. God, the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of holiness. Now I want to just try to conclude this. I'm enjoying myself. Are you enjoying yourself? You know why I'm enjoying myself? Not because I'm hearing myself talk. Because every time I step in this direction, His manifest presence becomes stronger and stronger. I do not have a speech impediment. I'm drunk in the Holy Ghost. Gwapa wants you to wake up intoxicated with His presence. Overwhelmed. I mean, it's a joy unspeakable. It has no physical or natural or human origin. A continual proof God the Holy Ghost is in charge. A continual proof. A happiness that you can't explain. You can't describe. Huh? A love that overpowers you and overwhelms you. A peace that passes understanding that nothing can disturb or take away. You know, the Lord said, of course, in Galatians 5, I'm talking about the evidence that the Holy Ghost is in your life. Some want to just relegate it to fruits of the Spirit that they pin up on a tree, like pinning a tail on a donkey. I know I can be pretty harsh, because I'm telling you right now, God's put His word in my mouth. I'm trying to say, look, I want to show you. God told me one day, He says, show my people their sins. Where they've taken the things that belong to me, my treasures, my sacred things, and they've turned them into foolish activities of religion. It's true. When they had the sacred, beautiful, glorious realms of divine and eternal life that Jesus paid such a high price for you and I to have. God said to Moses one day, I'm going to cause all my goodness to pass before you. Did you know that one of the evidences of the Holy Ghost, of walking in the Holy Ghost, is goodness? Can you imagine living 24 hours of goodness? Man, you got to give yourself to this. Because the more you give yourself, the stronger the influence, the more you will yield, the more you give yourself to love, the more you give yourself to joy, the more you give yourself to peace, the more you give yourself to the manifest presence of God, the stronger that glory is, not only to you, but also through you. Why is it that we're going to be lazy? Why is it we're going to check out on God and go occupy ourselves in a realm that cannot satisfy? An earthly realm. When we have a heavenly realm. When we're seated in a heavenly realm. Together with Him. When we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. When our conversation is in the heavenly realm. People, some of you are waiting to die to go to heaven. I'm telling you right now. You're already supposed to be dead. And in heaven. Huh? Somebody said, I'm dying. I die daily. Well, I hope you're having a resurrection daily too. I'm telling you right now, because it's a terrible, stinky thing to be dead, walking around over here dead. Come on. We dying. So I'm crucified with Christ. Say it. You need to get up. I mean, you need to say it so deep on the inside of you that you start believing. You need to get up and preach a sermon to yourself. You know, I'm crucified with Christ. I'm buried with Him by baptism into His death. I'm raised up together with Him. I'm alive together with Him. I'm seated with Him in the heavenly realm. I mean, to see your whole life and existence in Him. There is no life outside of Him. He that possesses Christ Jesus, the Son. And John has a reason to emphasize sonship and the Son in the verse of 1 John 5. He has a reason that he emphasizes Son instead of saying Jesus. Because he's drawing us into the very life and person of Christ Jesus in sonship. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. Ooh. Come on, man. Come on. This is beautiful. Oh, I want to be this. I want to be a prophet. I want to be an apostle. I want to be this. You get to be a son. You get to be a son. You get to be an heir of God. You get to be an heir. These signs, these miracles, follow them and believe. God's left you out of nothing. It's not like people want to try to bring us back into a priestly order. It's different now. We all high priest. And the high priest, Christ Jesus. We just all brought in. That same realm, divine access and glory and favor and honor and privilege. I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh when that day comes. You hear me now. That day is coming. And Father's looking for somebody
who in these last days will believe him. Because his eyes search, goes to and fro, that he might show himself mighty upon those who believe. We know that everyone who knows God in these last days shall be strong and do exploits. It's time for you to put on your strength. It's time you rise up, put on your mantle. Huh? I'm not interested in no anointing of Elijah. He's for another day. Elijah's the only Christian I know has to go through the tribulation. Elijah's for another day. He's for the tribulation. This is the mantle of the Son, Christ Jesus, the King of kings, in whom God trusted all the fullness of divine power bodily. And he's in me and I'm in him. What more could you ask for? What more could you desire? Come on, think about it, people. I want you to embrace Christ Jesus today. I want you to embrace the glory of God. You don't have to live in the shame and despair of a worldly system when God has opened the door for you to step into this life abundant. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, we want to move you to more than just an altar call in the meeting. We want to move you to a complete and total surrender and abandonment of your own life to now live out his life. That's not sacrificial. That's joy unspeakable. Hallelujah. I tell you, patience and humility is just as good as goodness. Because it's all the beautiful attributes of his glory, things that we have been separated, sanctified unto, set apart to do, to learn. We don't understand it. The world system says pride. God says humility. The world system, you know, has all these things about self-confidence when God says meekness. Father, show us confidence with meekness and boldness with humility. Divine confidence. For you know you can do all things. I can do all things through Christ, who empowers me, strengthens me, because I'm building myself up in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Yielded to the spot of the yeshatot on my which is more than just a charismatic expression. It's giving our whole being over to the influence of the Holy Ghost, because that's the way Father designed it. Said, I don't understand that. Well, then do you understand how Father got himself into a cloud and was like a fire by night and a cloud by day? Do you understand that? No. No. So don't get so wrapped up about not understanding. I can tell you right now, we got a list of things that you don't, many people go out and stir at the car. They don't even know how that works. He don't see so puzzled and concerned. It's the thing that it works. And if it doesn't work, you're going to go shout at somebody about it. I just got this thing and it ain't working. What did you do to me? I mean, you need to understand. What Father has supplied is ours. He's given it freely. It works. Sometimes people look at me and they say, what are you waiting for? I'm busting rocks in two. And you know, I bust rocks for what purpose? See some water come gushing out. Hallelujah. I know there's water back there. Bam! You're going to hit the thing again. Hit it again. Somebody said, hit me again. I'm still breathing. No, hit it again. The water hadn't started coming out yet. Smack it again. Go after it again. Throw the flame torch on that thing again. Throw the flame on that thing again. Oh, Zibeki and Asapaya. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you right now in Jesus' mighty name for the breakthrough. That your people will not be forgetful hearers of your word. That your people will not be captivated by a world called darkness. You mean you're going to wrap your whole life up into having a house and a car and a job? That's like setting your goals to be, have your eyes plucked out, your hair cut off, and go round and round grinding meal for the Philistines. That's your whole goal, doing the work of a donkey. This is your whole vision in life. My vision in life is to have my eyes plucked out, my hair cut off, and do the work of a donkey. Father's got big plans for you.
Hallelujah.
You know what he wants to do? He wants to reveal his son through you. He wants to reveal
His child, the one that he begat of his word and that he begat by his spirit, that is one with him, that belongs to him, that is his heir, not waiting to be heir. That is Paul's doctrine in Galatians chapter 4. Heir. You're no longer a child. That differs nothing more than a servant, though he be heir of all. Until the time appointed where he steps into the mature place or position of a son. But you are sons. Hallelujah. Heirs of God. And that's powerful, isn't it? What does it mean to be an heir of God according to Paul's doctrine in Galatians chapter 4? What does it mean to be an heir of God? The ability to function in every dimension of the ministry and person of Jesus Christ. Because that's who we are. We exist in him and live for him to do his work. To go everywhere doing what he's assigned us to do. Doing the same works which he did. This gospel of the kingdom must be preached. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me read one. Can I read one more? Do you feel the glory? If you don't, we want you to. Feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost? The wind of the Spirit? If you don't, we want you to. God wants you to. He wants to make you alive to these things, not dead to them anymore. He wants to make you sensitive to these things. Religion will desensitize you, will anesthetize you. I want to read one more verse of Scripture in Galatians chapter 3. I think this one verse of Scripture will ignite many verses of Scripture in me. That's just the way the Word of God is, isn't it? How many of you have been born of the incorruptible seed of God? You've been born of the incorruptible seed by the Word of God. You've been born by the Word. The miracle spoken Word of God. I love saying this. In all God's creative acts in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2, in the Hebrew language, the Scripture says, Vayomer Elohim, which is to translate, and God said. And every creative event ends with Vayehi Chin. Vayehi Chin means, and it was so. God said, and it was so. God has spoken over you and I through his manifest word, Christ Jesus. The logos, the definition, the revelation, the declaration, the determination, everything, the expression of God, the full expression of God. And yet we're not willing to let it be vayihichen. We're not willing to let it be so. We're waiting for another day. Well, I still just feel bad. You know, I love what Smith Wigglesworth said. He said, I don't wake up and say, Smith, how do you feel? I tell Smith how he feels. Huh? Hallelujah. Because he now began to let the Word of God rule him. Hallelujah. We just want you to let the Word of God rule you and tell you what you are and what you feel and what you're supposed to be doing, how you look. Hallelujah. We want you to go look at the mirror and say, woo! I don't know how I got looking so good, but my, praise God. Oh, yeah, that's what 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is all about. To behold in mirror the glory and there be changed. Hallelujah. Not veiled with the eyes of human perception, but with an unveiled face. A face that radiates with the lethal glory of God Almighty. That if you behold it, you cannot live. Which is on the face of Moses. I'm getting ready to get excited here in a minute. If there was a chandelier, I'd think about swinging. I've never seen anyone swing from a chandelier, though we've been accused of it. But if there's one available, who knows? Niente para. No, I just know that the presence and the power and the fire of God will hit you so that you can't sit still. God will make you so alive to the glory and the ways of his presence that you won't be able to sit still. And we're going to work on you till you get that sensitive to what he's doing. You won't be able to sit still. Fire of God will begin to burn on the inside of you. I'm telling you right now, the presence and the movings of God are far more impactful than anything else in this life, than electricity or any other force of this world of wind or wave. Someone said, what's the value of it? The value of it is that you get hooked up with the reality of a living God who wants to totally rule over your passions, your emotions. There are, only the Holy Ghost can touch you in the deepest parts of your emotions. You don't even have access to it. No man has access to it. People sit there and giggle because somebody says something funny, because somebody had a unique creativity to kind of produce humor. God goes so deep in the realms of joy unspeakable and full of glory. God's got so much wonderful expressions of life to touch you with here today, dear people. You don't have to live under the oppression of Satan's mandated sorrow. It's tyranny. Rise up. Rise up against it. Father's given you the authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. You don't have to live under the affliction and the torment of sin, sickness, and pain, and fear, and disease, and intimidation. No more. It's time to rise up. It's time to put on your glory now. It's time to be endued with Christ. Put on, therefore, the Lord Jesus Christ. What a privilege, what a mantle. Somebody said, oh, I wish I could have stood there with the glory, there in the glory that Moses stood in. No, no, there's a greater glory now. Oh, that's what 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is all about. Oh, I wish I could have had the mantle of Elijah to put on. No, there's a greater mantle now. It's the mantle of the anointing, of the anointed one, Christ Jesus. It's his mantle. It's an unlimited authority. It's the Holy Ghost. Without limit, without measure. It's to come into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus. I've heard many theologians say different things about that verse of Scripture, completely out of context to what Paul is saying, because he said, you're either going to do that or you're going to be children tossed to and fro by the tricks of men. And we watch this. It was time for us to go on to maturity. We stand at a crossroads. God has given to us his Holy Spirit. He's given to us his divine nature and made us a new creation, a new creature. A new heart, a new spirit. He's put his spirit on the inside of us. And we just stand here with it. And we're not willing to go on and mature and grow and be developed by the Holy Ghost by act of our own will to say from here on in, you have rulership over my emotions, my appetite, my desires, my passions. I set you before me. All I want is to be taught of you. God, lead me. I'm going to walk in you, live in you, be led by you. Should this turning back to God take place, great revival will happen. There's a great revival that's going to take place. I'm in the big middle of it. I don't know about you, what you're going to do, but I'm in the big middle of it. I'm prophesying till the thing happens. I was born for this. I'm Ben de Sipoya. Ha. Le Sicara Dom Brucifia. Ha ha. Manesh. Mongadea Paha. Menangadea. Mondea. I don't see anything else going on except for the purposes of God. The church is more powerful than any government on the face of the earth. The church is the fullness of him that filleth all things. In Christ Jesus is the head. God would give to us the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him, that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened, so that we may know what is the exceeding greatness of his power, which he brought to pass and gave to us when he raised Jesus from the dead, set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost upon us, and made him head over all principalities and powers and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come, but not only in this world, but also in this world right now, and also in the world to come. Jesus said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Anybody who believes, go now and do the things that I've mandated for you to do. All authority is mine now in heaven and in earth. The exceeding greatness of his power that was given to us when he raised Jesus from the dead, set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality, power, might, and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come, and give him to be the head over the church, which is the fullness of him that filleth all things right now. By the way, that's scripture.
case you didn't know. Ephesians 1:18-23. There's no joy. You can never access the joy of the Holy Ghost until you allow the Holy Spirit to be expressed through you with this divine utterance, because it's a divine outworking. You can never access it. You can have you a little hee-hee every once in a little while, and maybe a ha-ha too, but you're never going to have this joy, exceeding joy, great joy. You're going to have yourself a little bit of kindness, but you'll never know this love until you allow the Holy Ghost to pour this love on the inside of you, and then have free course through your life to express this love through your passions, your emotions, your appetite, your feeling, all that you are, all your intellect. He'll overwhelm you with His glory. To be overwhelmed with the glory of His love, if you've never had that experience, you want to have that experience. And once you do, you want to live in it all the time. Wow. I mean, it produced forgiveness on the inside of you, a mercy on the inside of you. It would cause you to want to go give your worst enemy, if you had one, a hug. You would be really saying from the depths of your heart, forgive them, Father. They don't know what they're doing because you're so in love with them. Because you're under the glory of the love, under the glory of the peace, under the glory of the joy, under the glory of His goodness, under the glory of His humility, under the glory of His meekness, under the glory of His godliness, under the glory of all those things that belong to His own nature, His own ways, His own character, which is the expression of true life, real life. It's not a dark life. It's not dead while you live. He that possesses Jesus Christ the Son has life. He that does not possess, have living on the inside of them. Christ Jesus is dead while He lives. They don't have life. Don't believe every spirit, but try the spirits, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. Every spirit that confessed that Jesus Christ has come, for the greater one on the inside has come in the flesh, not only in the flesh, as the one born of Mary, as the one who took upon Himself the garments and the robes of a servant, and made like unto a person who is formed and fashioned as a man, but has come in here and dwells and lives right here, right now, for greater is He that is in us. And by this wonderful faith and by this wonderful act of His divine grace, we've overcome Him, the world, the power that is in the world, the wicked one, His wickedness. I see right through His lust. I know what it's all about is to damn the soul. The wages of sin is death. The greatest wisdom you can have in the midst of the heat of the battle, where Satan lays upon your soul the temptation of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, the insights of the divine, to recognize all Satan would do is seal you with his lies, mark you with his death. And now you're ready to be fit for the battle. You cry, "Oh God, arise and go before me, that your enemies may be scattered." Works every time. Hallelujah. There may have been a time where Eli laid down blind the fat slothfulness of his own flesh, and his sons Hophni and Phinehas laid with the women at the door of the church. But now it's time for those who sit in the presence of the Lord to begin to shine. A transition is taking place. Those that have walked with Father, that have not been, as it were, in the limelight of men's realms, God's about to cause His word to be spoken so that men may begin to tremble, so that the earth will shake again. There's going to be then again, once again, people who will have an anointing and understanding. As George Whitefield would say when he would cry out to the people there in Philadelphia that were up in the trees, and said, "Come down out of the trees, because I'm getting ready to make an altar call. And when I do, the power of God's going to so come upon you, you'll begin to shake and tremble, and you'll fall and you'll hurt yourself." You know what happened to George Whitefield? He was sitting on a bench in Oxford one day, and suddenly the Lord caused him to realize, a man must be born again. It was in 17, in seven. Listen, this literally is true. In the 1740s, 1750s, it was a lost doctrine of the church. John chapter 3 was completely eclipsed. God revealed to him, a man must be born again, that the Spirit of the Lord would come upon a person if they were willing and make them a new creation.
And so what he would begin to do is he would begin to talk about the Holy Ghost coming upon people to change them into a new creation. And that's when the people begin to shake kind of the power of God, when he make an altar call and say, here's what the Lord has shown me. You must be born again. There's another great outpouring of divine favor and grace, because Father in his loving kindness and tender mercy is not willing that any perish. And there are people like me who have wholly turned themselves unto the Lord, have wholly given themselves over to the ways of the King, who have no desire for the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, who now have no desire to participate with demon spirits, because he that sins is of the devil. Uh-oh. Somebody said, Mark, would you please from here on in just say, he that practiced sin is of the devil, so we can feel better about ourselves. No, I'm not going to say it. I'm going to say, he that sins is of the devil. Would you like for me to say it to you in Greek? Because it says exactly the same thing. There's no practice there. He that sins is of the devil. He that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. Ooh. Even as he is righteous. No, please dilute it. Please dilute it. Please, would you please dilute it? Would you please water that down? I can't handle whole milk. It upsets me. I need 90-10. No, I need 95-5. Oh, I'm going to give you 95-5. Okay, we'll give you 95 water of the Holy Ghost and 5% milk of the Word. Not too, still too strong? Well, let me put down a 99.99% of the water of the Holy Ghost. Eshi puya namahata. Let me just, can I read this to you?
Yes.
Are you earnest?
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Are you waiting to die and go to heaven? Are you in heaven now? How much of a transition do you want between where you're at right now and when you step over in that realm with him? Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and though it does not appear what we should be, we know that we shall see him as he is. For we shall be like him. What? John, what are you saying? Every man that hath this hope purifieth himself even as he is pure. And God has given us everything that we need by his divine power. He's given us this everything that we need if we're willing to stay over here with him in his realm. And say, no, I'm touch not, hand not. No. What shall you buy? I buy the truth and sell it not. Hallelujah. I'm not going to be a part of that realm. I refuse to be a part. So many of you have integrated. You've either been neutralized or assimilated, or you just fully surrendered to be integrated with the world. God has separated us absolutely and totally and demands that then we be willing to participate with that. Will you?
Yeah.
Will you no longer allow sorrow and sadness to rule you? It's supposed to flee away. The redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion. And everlasting joy should be upon their head. What does that look like? They shall receive or have or obtain gladness and joy. And sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The Lord has not given us a spirit of bondage to fear, but his spirit of his son, whereby we cry out, Almighty God is my dad. I missed again. Almighty God is my dad. Almighty God is my dad.
Thank you, Lord.
I feel exactly the same way. I'm just being sober. I'm being sober for a few of you who still haven't gotten it yet. Because Bob's going to give it to you. You want these things? You want it? Can't just be another religion. Galatians chapter 3. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everybody stand with me. Look there at verse 14 with me, those of you who have your Bibles open. I pray that you open your Bible and you'll never shut it. Hallelujah. 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 I have a river of life, and it's flowing out of me. Hallelujah. It makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. But it all begins with the utterances of the Holy Ghost, the divine utterances of the Spirit. Christ Jesus redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. Jesus. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs upon a tree. That the blessing of Abraham. I make you the heir of the world, Abraham. All the things that I have, I give them to you. Look now. And behold, to the east and the west, north and south, look over time and eternity. I give it to you, that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. When Father is talking to Abraham, he's talking to Abraham about the oneness that he would bring him into with himself. The covenant that he bound himself to. The heirship, the sonship, the faith. That we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Jesus said in Acts 1:5, he said, go wait for the promise of the Father. In Acts 24, 48 and 49. Go wait for the promise of the Father, Paul said. You've been sealed with the Spirit of promise. The promise of the Father, which said he, you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. It shall come to pass in the last day, saith God. I pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. So many of you want to take Joel, what God said by Joel, apply it out of context. But Peter's context was that wonderful event when they began to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire and begin to have this wonderful expressions of the Spirit of the Lord. Speaking through their lips. With these divine utterances. They only come by the Holy Ghost. If you let God begin to take out of your, begin to take over the way you talk, the way you speak, He'll begin to take over the way you think. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You just begin to let God, the Holy Ghost, have free course through you.
begin to let his joy. Too many people give their members over to things opposite of joy. They've lived in a depressed world. They've lived in a sorrow and sad world. They've lived in a world of heaviness, and they don't know how to just yield their members unto righteousness, under the ways of God. You've never been willing to come up against the battle of the things that have oppressed your mind, your heart today, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father's here to show you how to live in a whole nother realm, in a whole nother existence, in a whole nother way. The promise of the Spirit that has come to us by faith, the promise that Father made to Abraham when he showed him Christ Jesus from afar off, when he showed him the realms of the covenant that would come forth from his loins, from his seed. A promise that did not end with the cross. It began. A promise that did not end with the resurrection. It began. A promise that is secure, that is made manifest by the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, the ministry of Jesus, who's still the baptizer, Jesus the baptizer. Not just John the baptizer. Jesus Christ the baptizer. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Why don't you surrender all your other desires to him right now? Surrender all your other desires to him right now. Because I'm going to tell you right now, other desires. When I'm in a Hindu nation, I tell the Hindus, you must renounce all other gods. Because I know about Hindus. They're just going to take another god. They don't want to offend any deity. You must renounce all other gods if you want Jesus. I say to Americans, you have got to renounce all other passions, all other desires, all other pursuits, because you can't mix it up with him. Jesus said it, that above everything else, first place, it's the kingdom and his righteousness. Oh, it's that which God has for you. It's the life that he's given. Needs to become more valuable to you than anything else. And I pray in the name of Jesus that everything that stood in your way from this day forward, it will not be able to hinder you anymore. That you, every person in this, not just one, not just two, because, you know, I was crying out to God for a season of my life about this great outpouring of the Holy Ghost that's about to be seen in the earth. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. And he said, it will not be a few, but it will be a great army. Not just one or two, but a mighty host shall stand. A mighty host. That includes you. God's not excluded you. God's not going to do through you those things he wants to do through you because you've got yourself all straightened out. God's going to do the things he wants to do through you because you learned how to yield to him. There's a certain amount of battle there because there's things that would be the enemy and circumstance would try to impose upon you, and you've got to learn how to let God arise through you today. He wants to bless you. Father wants to bless you with something far better than a better job. Father wants to bless you and just far better than anything that can be seen in the earthly realm. He wants to bless you with all those things that belong to heaven. Can you hear Father say, I am your shield. I am your shield. I am your exceeding great reward. Can you hear him say it to you? Can you feel and see and understand the promise that Father has made to Abraham now come into your life? Can you see it? Can you feel it? Are you willing to be separated unto it? Are you willing to make that the reality of everything that's going on in your life and all that you want? Are you willing to let the Holy Spirit teach you the ways of life? If you are, right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, I'm telling you, God says, come. and I'll do it. Just come unto me. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Come. He says, come. Father says, come. Lord, I thank you that in your love and in your mercy, that you begin to reveal to hearts and minds things that only you can show and only you can make known. Lord, that if there is anything that goes on in our life where we're hanging on, we've got desires for something in this world more than we have for you, that we'll be able to see it and be able to refuse it so it can't interfere no more. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the glory of his life overwhelm you. Let his presence touch you now. Let the Father show you what you've been missing. Don't let the thief come and steal from you no more. For Jesus has come to give you a life that's so abundant, a God kind of life, a life that's so full of every good thing. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Like a mighty wind, Father, we pray. Right now in Jesus' name. Every person in this place, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Right now in Jesus' name. God, the Holy Ghost wants to make you feel heavenly. He wants to so fill you up with every good thing that pertains to life and godliness. Because he's called you to the glory.